Okay. Right, thank you all for coming to this session. And community-based learning is a learning methodology that many people across AUC are experimenting with, and they're bringing a lot of benefit to the university and to their students and to the community as well. Okay, so that's what we're covering today. And just before we start, I'd like for each person just to introduce who they are and what departments they're from, so that we can kind of gear the kinds of things that we are discussing towards those departmental goals and your learning objectives. Okay, should we start with Jasmine?
I'm from rhetoric and composition.
Okay. So Jasmine Maklad from rhetoric. And, yeah,
Jasmine because. Do you want me to talk about our goals?
No, just the department, because we'll get to talk about exactly what you're doing in another session today.
Okay.
Okay, so just who you are and what departments, because some of us know each other, but some of us don't.
Okay, then I'll have a soul,
ELR. That's Arabic language.
Arabic language instruction.
Yeah.
Well, yours was what?
Rhetoric and composition. Teach, like,
please,
research, right?
Florin, hello. Good. Just pull a seat here. Okay, it's a small group, but we're growing. So we're just introducing everybody. Jasmine from Rhetoric and Composition, Dalel from Arabic Language Instruction, Dina Goma from Rhetoric and Composition.
Ahmed Saqib Al-Hayd from Graphic Design Program.
Graphic Design, okay.
Iman Haman from Rhetoric.
From Rhetoric and Composition.
And Florin Balassa from Computer Science.
Okay, Florin, Computer Science. So people from any discipline, okay, can make use of a particular teaching methodology, whatever they're teaching, whether it's chemistry or arts or writing classes or whatever it is. Okay, so I'm going to ask Florin to kind of turn. Yeah, I just want to acknowledge the people who are presenting today with me. There's also I'm Amani Shimi from Rhetoric and Composition, Dr. Mona Amer from Psychology, who's going to be joining us in a few minutes, inshallah. Also Pandali Glavanis, who was not able to be with us today, but who has always been part of community-based learning faculty development on campus, and he's also the director of Academic Community Engagement, ACE, program, which functions under the Dean of Undergraduate Studies. Okay? Right, so community-based learning principles, practices, and assessment. And just a minute ago, I asked people what they thought community-based learning meant. Okay? Can I ask you, Florin, what is your initial kind of definition for it?
Well, I always assume that, teaching, so it's a distance learning, but local distance, this was in my mind. I mean, not very far away.
Okay.
but also probably techniques which would enhance the participation of, let's say, less favored people in your area.
Okay. Okay, I like the word participation.
Yeah.
And we'll kind of emphasize that again in a minute. Ahmed, I haven't asked you.
It was a very interesting title for me. Because,
good.
A lot of projects that I teach my students are targeted towards the community service.
Good.
But the community-based learning, this is what I'm just...
Thank you for making the distinction, and we'll come to that in a minute, okay? I also just want to alert everybody that the session is being recorded because it will be shared with another audience, okay? An audience that is regional from other universities in the area. So they're mostly recording the presentation, okay? In the later sessions where we have just the discussion groups and the talk about your particular class, that's not going to be recorded. Okay, if anybody has a problem with the recording, let me know and I'll take measures. Thank you. All right. So this is how the American University in Cairo, this is how we've chosen to define community-based learning. It's a teaching method, okay? So the goal is the teaching and the learning. And you're using a particular methodology, and we're going to describe how that is done in a few minutes. But it's a teaching method that purposefully, you have that intention, purposefully advances course learning goals through service to a partner community. In other words, you already have your course learning goals or course learning outcomes set out in the syllabus. Perhaps you have three sections of the same course. All three sections will have the same learning outcomes, right? Maybe one teacher chooses to teach through community-based learning methods. Another teacher chooses to teach through students doing research. And a third teacher chooses exam type, you know, just study, lecture mode, and examination. All three sections, by the end of the semester, will arrive at the same learning outcomes. It's the method that changes, okay? But community-based learning will bring in this added benefit to it as well. And that's what we're talking about in this session, okay? And the kind of method you choose in your section has to be what best fulfills the learning outcomes or helps students fulfill the learning outcomes. You have to remember community-based learning is an excellent method, but it's not the be-all and end-all. If it's better for me to teach through lab experimentation because it will teach the students those learning outcomes better, then that's what I will select. Okay? So it's a teaching method with huge added benefits. That's why we're learning about it, to consider if it would or would not work best for our class and how to make best use of it. Okay, so I'll share with you another definition that comes from Campus Compact. Campus Compact is an organization based in the US, but it has lots of affiliations and branches all over the United States mostly. Okay, but then there are also other regional associations that do the kind of work that Campus Compact does in the US. And one of those associations is the MAN Alliance for Arab Universities for Civic Engagement, okay, which we are also recording this session for. Okay, so what does Campus Compact do to define community-based learning? It says it's a process through which students are involved in community work that contributes to two things: positive change in individuals, organizations, neighborhoods, and or larger systems in a community. Okay, so as the students are learning and producing work, that delivers a positive change. It delivers a service that creates positive change, I hope, not negative change, okay, in a community. And the other contribution is, it contributes to students' academic understanding, civic development, so they get to see how their learning connects to the larger issues in the community, or they get to feel that they are part of this community, so they're developing a civic identity and a civic responsibility, okay? So it contributes to academic understanding, civic development, personal growth, and we'll talk about each of these, and understanding of the larger societal or social issues, okay? Now, I would say, this is Mona Emer, my colleague from psychology, Professor Mona Emer, who's going to be also part of this presentation. Right, so it's a process through which students are involved in community work that contributes to these two things: my own learning and development as a student and service to the community. I always, every time I look at this slide, I want to email Campus Compact and tell them, please switch the order of the bullet points, you know? Because as a teacher, my goal is to help the students learn through the best way possible. And I want to select this method because it also creates positive change in the community. But my priority is the students. If the students are creating huge positive change in the community, but they're not achieving the course learning outcomes, then I have failed them as a teacher. Okay, So that's why I really think that the bullet points should change order, but maybe they're parallel, who knows?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So some of the key elements that define what community-based learning is. We'll have some discussion with this slide. So we've already talked about this. The service has to be aligned to the course learning goals. It has to be. So if I'm teaching chemistry, okay, and my students are learning to go through, you know, chemical methods and experimentation or whatever, I don't want to take my students out to the community and have them, you know, tour a particular area and then perhaps engage with the community through teaching them literacy classes. Mm. You use the word community service. That's the difference. Community service, I could be doing any service in the community. The students are learning something, they're growing, but community-based learning ensures that they are learning what the course sets out to fulfill. Okay? Maybe I have three different chemistry courses, they will have three different sets of learning outcomes. I want to make sure that whatever service the students are working on, okay, takes forward or advances the kind of learning they are supposed to learn in this class. Not in another chemistry class, not in an arts class, okay, not in a literacy class, but in my section that I'm teaching in that chemistry department. So alignment of the project that I'm doing with the course goals. I think you use the word participatory, or you want the community to participate, okay? So we want a participatory approach. Why? What does that mean? What does a participatory approach mean?
That they're not just recipients of it, they're not passive sort of partners in this.
The community.
Yeah.
Good, okay? Yeah. Especially here in Egypt, a lot of the, if you're accessing, you know, communities that are low socioeconomic level, whatever, the expectation from the community is that you're going to give them something. Mm-hmm. They're going to be in this recipient position. They're waiting for you to give them something.
Also from those giving as well, there's an attitude that...
Good.
Yeah.
What is the attitude?
I'm trying to frame it in a nice way, but of that, you know, I have something that you don't have, and I'm giving it to you. I mean, there's a bit of a
good. Yes, yes.
I can't express it. Yeah, maybe condescending or
privileged.
Good, approach. Good. Yeah, and that's exactly what the literature says. Okay, it says that you don't want to parachute. They use that word. You don't want to parachute onto a community. Okay. And tell them, we're giving you this service because you need it. Okay? I'm going to give you an example from my own experience a long time ago. We wanted to work with a community called the Stabla Antar, and this is going to come up quite a bit. So what we did was we got videos, documentaries, about the area, and we watched them. And the videos were developed by an NGO that works in the area. And we could see the homes and we could see how much they needed a lot of infrastructure. And they didn't have water. They had access to water 2 hours a day, 2 days a week, and a total of 4 hours a week. And then they had to buy their water, and it was like 170 pounds, a small barrel of water. Okay? It was, so as we watched the video and then we talked about, you know, what is it that we can do? And it was a class where we were writing grant proposals. So we wanted to write a grant proposal for the NGO in the area to help them get funding to work on these projects. And we thought, well, what kinds of projects would they need? And we thought, well, they need water, potable water, you know, water they can use for cooking. So they need a water system. One student said they need roofing. Okay, their homes, they're covered in straw and tin and cardboard. They need a proper roofing system. So this was our initial brainstorming. But when we visited the community and we talked to the people, that's not what they wanted at all. At all. Okay? We told them, but you don't, you know, water. You need water. And you know what they said? They said, Alhamdulillah, binakhud kifayatna. Okay? We take what we need. We have enough. Okay? I was in tears, at the end.
So yeah? What did they want? They want to discuss philosophy?
No. No. They said, what is more important for us is to have a sewage system. Okay? They wanted to create, because they don't have a proper sewage system. Sablantar is on an elevation. The streets are very, very narrow. Okay, and what they have is trenches. The trenches fill, okay, and then every 3 months or so, some truck comes along, it's called a kaseha or something like that, and it empties the trenches of the sewage. Now, sewage also means water that drains from anything you use. If you're washing clothes, where does the water go? If it goes in the trench overflows into the homes with everything else. Okay? So what did they do? They would take the water that they use for the washing and they go outside the home. They throw it outside the home and it seeps into the hilly landscape. And then you get things like rock slides, like in Duea. So they wanted a proper sewage system. Okay? This was a technical communication class that I was teaching. They were writing grant proposals as a technical kind of document. So it's a technical communication, and most of the students registered were engineering students. They got a faculty advisor for the content part of how to do it, and they wrote out a very detailed plan for a sewage system with a grant proposal. My role as a writing teacher was to help them put together a meaningful, well-organized, communicative, persuasive grant proposal. Okay, and we submitted that to the NGO. So when I talk about participatory,
Did they get the sewer system?
They got parts of the funding. Okay, what they do is they translate it back into Arabic, and they use it with donors here. Okay, and they get bits and pieces of funding. Maybe they don't get the whole thing.
Okay.
But they do have a system that works for them, okay? But it's not like a government dug full-scale sewage network. It's not. Okay? Okay, so participatory, you want to be working with, notice the preposition, with the people in the community. You're not working for, you're not working about, you're not, you know, doing research about them, and you're not doing research for them, you're doing research with them. They are part of the needs definition, okay? They are part of prioritizing what they want. They're part of the decision taking. They're giving you a lot of information. That's why community-based learning is work. Okay, you're in constant communication with whoever that other partner is. I will not use the word recipient. Okay? We call it a partner. Recipient gives you that hierarchical kind of framework. Somebody's at the top, somebody's at the bottom, and somebody is a giver, somebody is a taker. But we are working more on an egalitarian framework. Okay, there's equity, there's a partnership, which takes us to the next point, which is reciprocity. Reciprocity. There's reciprocal gain.
How do you reach trust?
Okay, that's a good question. And remind me to come back to that in a minute, okay? So we're talking about reciprocity. Reciprocity in the sense that I, as a class, students and faculty, we understand that we have a lot to learn. We enter with this humility. We will learn a great deal. This is our learning ground. They have a lot to give us. They have so much community knowledge that we don't. Okay? And they know that they have a lot to learn as well, and a lot to and a lot to give. Okay, so that. Okay, that's the same question, and I'll come to that in a minute. Okay, I'll reframe the question. The question is, how do you create this trusted partnership? Okay, and we'll come to that in a. It's work. It is work. Okay. So the community then knows that they are not only receiving, but they are giving. They are supporting student learning. They are providing and the space, the contacts, the information, okay? And they are able to accommodate these students to support their learning. So it's a very different concept of my role as a community member. Okay? I'm not just here to get something out of these rich kids from AUC. Okay? No, I'm definitely here in this equal partnership mode, and I can give something, I can support. Okay?
I was going to ask, I mean, when you've done it in the past, have you done anything with the community themselves to make them aware of that? Because
yes.
I think that they're, okay.
Yes. Okay. So let me now kind of, before I get into the next key elements, answer the question that has come up. How do you build trust, and how do you prepare the community? Now, when I say community, I wish there was a board here, for goodness sake. Yeah? Yeah. When we talk about community, we are talking about different levels or different entities within the community. Okay? We talk about the NGO, which is the community partner. We as teachers and students cannot just enter a community and work with the people. Okay? Probably we'll get into trouble. Because it's not our mission to be working with the general public in that manner. But definitely we can partner with an organization, an NGO, whose mission is to work with the general public. So when we talk about the community partner, we are usually talking about the organization that we partner with. So when I worked in Stabla Antar, I didn't just take my students and go, أهلاً وسهلاً إحنا من الجامعة الأمريكية. No, we had to find an NGO that worked in the area, okay, and it was called Tawasul. And this is where we had this conversation. This is where we provided the orientation and training for what is community-based learning, what is it supposed to do. And definitely Tawasul, they assigned a person to our project. That person became the contact person. This is the person that facilitated contacts with this other level, which I'm going to call the beneficiaries. So we have the community organization that is our partner, and we have the beneficiaries. Okay, the beneficiaries, I shouldn't be doing this because it's hierarchical. Okay, I should be doing this, yeah.
They're partners, they're not.
They are partners.
Beneficiaries more of the passive.
Well, it's the term in the literature. Okay, you're right, you're absolutely right. Okay?
We're benefiting as well.
Do you have another word, Mona?
For partner?
No, we have the community partner, and usually we talk about the community partner as being the organization.
Partner then, too.
The beneficiary partner, right. And then we have the community that the NGO serves. What do we call the community that the beneficiary, the organization serves?
Community members.
Okay. So yeah. So our partner is the NGO because they will have the permit to work in the area, and they will facilitate the contacts. They will manage the meetings and that kind of thing. Okay. And the community members, which is a nice word. True, I should stop using beneficiary. The community members are this other partner that we are working with. Okay? And they are the people we collect a lot of information from. And they are the people whose assets we talk about and whose needs we talk about and who choose and prioritize what they want. But it's all done through this mediary agent, which we call the community partner.
Do they know that they are dealing with students?
Yeah.
It doesn't upset them or annoy them or throw them off in Nodul Habitayel?
No.
No? Okay.
If they do, okay, mm-hmm. then we have to do a lot of work to gain their trust.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when we did that Tawasul partnership, and we worked in Stabla Antar, initially we met with some key people in the community members through the NGO. The NGO invited some key people, so Kibir, you know, المنطقة, the, do you understand some Arabic? All right. So yeah, the kind of chief kind of guy, the imam of the mosque. All right. Certain women who have strength amongst the female community, whatever. So the NGO invited these people initially. We spoke to them, and then they led us through the community, and we talked to people. We entered their homes. We spoke to them. Okay. They gave us the nicest tea with mint. And you'd think, you know, low socioeconomic areas would be unclean. Their homes were spotless inside. The community outside is a garbage dump.
Mm-hmm.
Inside their homes, it's spotless. It's spotless. It's so wonderful. I mean, it's clean. And the glasses are wonderful and the tea, ahla shay, okay?
And they had no gender problems. You're being women.
No, not at all. No, because they were excited.
I had an experience where a student said, I was doing some community work, and one of the students said, أنا مش هتعلمني واحدة ست.
Then you need
to... That was in Mansouria, يعني, where I live.
Okay, so that gives you a lesson.
Mm.
There's a lot of preparatory work that needs to be done before people enter the community. Now, I'm using a model that works here in Egypt, and it's really an important model, this partnership that the university is an entity, and the community is an entity, and we enter a partnership like we are two entities.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a metaphor that is a business metaphor.
Mm-hmm.
We're creating this partnership. In other contexts, it's not like that.
Mm-hmm.
The university is the community.
Mm-hmm.
The community is what provides students for the university, and the university serves the community which it is completely integrated within. So it's not a partnership model. It's very much I'm serving my community.
Mm-hmm.
For AUC, AUC is so isolated.
Mm-hmm.
It's this bubble.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So we are entering a community that in the form of a partnership, and we're learning so much from them, and they're learning from us, but we have to prepare to create that trust.
Mm.
Okay?
No, I was just going to say when you were saying that I've noticed with things before that the students have, and ourselves as well, I'm sure, but a lot of preconceived ideas. So, I mean, I think it's a good idea to have an activity before you even start.
Yes.
Something like that, you know, what is it that you're expecting? Are you expecting dirty cups? Are you expecting, I don't know, because then you become a bit more aware of all of these preconceived ideas that you have and how they, you know, how most probably are not accurate.
So yes,
it
absolutely.
Helps, once you become consciously aware of it, it makes it easier to then sort of drop them and just deal with people as they are.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Jasmine, because
I'll
come back to that again.
I may ask you. Kind of community learning projects did we have at AUC for instance?
Okay, that's coming in the next slides. I'm going to give some examples, okay? But what Jasmine was saying, okay, will be the next point, which is reflection, okay? And reflection has to do with that preparation before and then during and then after the process. And when we shift to the next session, which is assessment, I'll get into different models of reflection. But a reflective exercise allows you to test your assumptions, express them, articulate your assumptions, and then kind of discuss them, test them, understand that they are assumptions, you know, break down stereotypes, identify prejudices within you that you don't normally talk about. Okay? It gets you really thinking about how you perceive yourself vis-a-vis this other that begins as an other, maybe, for some people. Okay? And the same kind of reflection can also be done when we're doing the community preparation. And then after they enter the community and we start doing a bit of work, you can bring in other reflective exercises. And you can see quite a difference. Okay? And then after. We'll get more into that detail in the next session. Okay. So, what did I want to say? So reciprocity, is there reciprocal gain? Is the community an equal partner? Is there empowerment and mutual respect? Okay, so we have to prepare ourselves for that. Usually before we go, if I'm going to a very different kind of community than the one AUC is familiar with, okay, then I will give that prep talk to the students and we will do that reflection, okay? And I will even have them prepare in terms of what is it that I need to wear? How is it that I need to behave there? And these are all things I learned the hard way. Okay? I mean, I have taken students very early on when I started doing community-based learning with minimal kind of orientation and preparation. And I was appalled because people stopped talking to each other and they were just watching us, you know, like, Edol, who are these people? Because of the behaviors, okay? So even proximity between males and females in the class, okay, that level. So I had a girl who gave her back to somebody to write a note on, you know, he was just leaning on her back and writing a note. And people were, you know, staring at them, what is this? Okay, the students were doing it in goodwill, you know, okay, things like chewing gum, very visibly. Things like the girls smoking, they had no problem with the boys smoking. But with the girls smoking, I was there, you know, on my toes, I was alert to everything that was being said, and I could hear, okay, there's a lot of judgment. So this preparation has to happen. How to be, you know, how not to kind of attract attention to stark differences, okay, and to build that trust. It's all learning about who am I. I'm not just within the AUC walls. This is the rest of Egypt.
I have to say this, sorry, I can't control myself.
This is the place for it.
It's unfortunate that the students themselves don't have that, even that small level of awareness. I mean, maybe riding on someone's back, you're not going to think about it. There's
empathy,
other things.
Some empathy is necessary.
The vocabulary, bezupt, the drop-down jeans kind of thing, you know.
Communities are more conservative. So
absolutely. So just this, all of this is building an awareness. It's kind of expanding your perception of what is my community. I'm Egyptian, okay, or I live within this community. Who's outside my tight walls? Okay. So we have a lot of discussions that come back to the issues we are discussing. So reflection, this is something that we'll talk a lot about, sure. But reflection, what does that mean? What does the word reflection mean?
To think.
When does it happen?
Critically.
When does reflection happen?
Okay.
Before,
to think
during,
critically,
or after?
All of the above.
All of the above.
Yeah.
Okay.
So yes, reflection is conscious. Your
conscious
intentional, yes, it's
realize,
your, sorry?
To realize.
Okay.
It's an awareness, it's and a
analysis.
Conscious decision to be aware and,
good.
And to think about things and connections.
Good. I like the fact that you're emphasizing intentionality. Mm. Okay, it's a conscious decision, you said. There's intentionality. I am thinking about my learning. I am thinking about my thinking. It's this metacognitive level of engagement. Okay? So I'm thinking about, well, how does this connect to my learning outcomes? How does it connect to the kinds of theories I'm reading in class? Or to the, how does the exercise that I'm building with the community, okay? How is it building this learning for me? I mean, what does it mean? How can I make it better? And we'll get into models for how to conduct reflection later, inshallah. But reflection is a necessity. Reflection is a teaching method anyway, all on its own, whether or not you're doing community-based learning. You can engage the students in reflection after they watch a presentation, after they watch a movie, after they read a text, after they write an essay. You can engage in this metacognitive exercise. But it's especially necessary when you are doing so much work outside of the text, outside of the walls of the classroom. You need the students to intentionally see those connections, okay, and plan for how do I make it better? How do I make it meaningful? How do I, you know, what's it doing to me? What's it giving me? How, you know, what am I learning about myself? What am I learning about the community? So it's especially necessary in community-based learning, because if you don't have it, there is the danger of students kind of isolating the classwork and the community work. And it's like they're two parallel things that don't meet. Okay? Jasmine, you had something to say. Yeah? Okay, and then we go into celebration. I mean, it sounds really festive, but what I wanted to emphasize is that people need to bring closure to an activity. The community timeline is quite different from the student timeline. The students begin a project and then, hey, I have midterms, Masharif A, I stop going sometime for large gaps of time in the middle of the semester, and then maybe I come back and I want to finish up my paper or my proposal or whatever, and then I disappear, and the community are left with Hawafi'i, you know, did they finish? Nobody told us anything. That's unethical. And I'll come back to ethics, I hope. Okay, in a minute. But anyway, so a celebration kind of brings closure to the activity. Maybe it's in the form of inviting them when I'm giving the final presentation of the project that we've developed. Okay? Or when I'm presenting the work. Okay? Maybe it's a website that I've developed for them. Maybe it's something. So,
big pictures or
whatever. So I have a kind of activity that kind of brings closure to this. I know Mona does this when she works a lot with Alashenik Ya Beledi. And the students all semester are doing a needs assessment, an assets assessment, they're developing projects, whatever. And then at the end of the semester, they're inviting that NGO to the class, or maybe they're going to the NGO, where the students are presenting and they're having this discussion and evaluation of the work and how to make it better and how to use it, how to make it sustainable. And then there's like, you know, refreshments, whatever, together. It's a kind of celebration, but ultimately it's a form of closure. The community knows that, thank you, this has been a wonderful experience, and maybe I will start working with a new group of students. Dissemination of the work, which we are so poor at. Okay, if students have done something good, let them present it in a conference. Let them publish. Spreading the knowledge, sharing the knowledge.
Like
nashr?
What's the equivalent?
Yeah, nashr al-ilm. Okay, so you spread it. So maybe I have a website and I publish my material on it. Maybe the students are presenting at conferences or publishing papers in journals. Maybe I'm just making it available on the NGO website. Why? Because other people can learn from it. The community impact can multiply if it's accessible to others. When I search for anything, everything I'm getting is from the United States, from the UK, from Australia. Nothing, very little, comes out of this region. Well, it's time we spread our good work. We learn from India, we learn from Malaysia, from Japan. There's material there about what they do, very little from this region. So dissemination is about knowledge sharing. Okay? Yeah, I'm going to go through this really quickly. Okay. So, when you're doing, I just had this slide because I hope some of you will go back and you will do your own search to learn a little bit more, to find things to read. So what are the differences between these different terms? We've already talked about the difference between community service and community-based learning. There's learning and there's service in both. Okay? But community service may be done outside of the curriculum. It is co-curricular. All of the student community service clubs, they host students from every discipline. Yeah, from the arts and from chemistry and from computer science and from writing. But they're all doing this one community service project because it's not tied to a course learning outcomes. It may be tied to the club outcomes. Okay? Community-based learning is academic in the sense that it is curricular. It's embedded in the curriculum. It's part of your... It's a method that the teacher chooses to use to advance the course learning outcomes. That's how we defined it. Okay? Experiential education. That's a broader term. What does experiential mean?
Through experience,
through learning by doing. Community-based learning isn't a form of experiential learning. But so is doing experiments in the lab. That's experiential learning too. You're learning through doing. Mm. Yeah? A lot of experiences fall under experiential education. Community-based learning is narrower than that term. Okay, it's one form. An internship, what's the difference?
It's not necessarily linked with course goals.
Yeah, or it could be, you're teaching one next semester.
Yeah. I said okay. Not necessarily.
Yes. Yeah. So an internship is a term that is that traditionally comes from a business context. Okay, it's the concept is tied with career preparation. You're getting some job experience, but you are giving service hours to either the corporate firm you're working with or the NGO you are working with. Okay? You are giving a service, but it's for the intention there is for your career kind of development. All right. So there's a lot of overlap and similarity, but we use the term community-based learning because it's a term we've selected for this curricular kind of service that advances the learning. Okay? Field research.
It's about.
Good. It's not with. It's about. It's not about giving the service. Field research, I'm going out to collect data because it's going to give me, you know, I'm going to analyze this data and come up with findings that feed my research. My research is field-based, okay? Which is different from community-based research. Community-based research is participatory. And it is for and with the community, okay? Volunteerism, that's a word we use just to describe, you know, I'm doing this, it's not for credit, it's not for pay, I've selected to volunteer for this. Community-based learning is for credit, okay? The other term that is the most synonymous is service learning. There's a big debate about whether service learning is with a hyphen or without a hyphen. I kind of like the hyphen, but I don't know why I opted not to have it here. Okay, service learning with a hyphen is a teaching method, okay, is a teaching method. The head noun is the learning, yeah, but it's service learning. I'm learning through service, okay, and there is an impact that I'm creating, but I'm also growing as a student, academically, personally, and civically, okay. Yes.
By teaching them.
Okay, yeah. It is, yeah. So if you want to find more literature and read more about this, you may use the term service learning. It will generate an abundance of things, wonderful things to read. In fact, when I first started doing this, I was doing service learning in my mind because I learned about service learning actually from Tim Sullivan, who was here as a provost for a while, he used the word in passing keda in some meeting that was happening in the Senate. And I kind of thought, you know, that sounds really interesting, especially for a writing class. I want the students to kind of tie up the writing to a real life goal so that it makes sense to them. Because one of the students had written on my student evaluations, okay, what happens with all this writing? It just goes into the teacher's recycle bin. And I thought, wow, you know, this is an opportunity for me to make the writing really serve an authentic purpose that goes beyond the end of semester and, you know, the tick at the end of the semester and the grade. So I read about service learning and I learned about it and then I experimented and then I gave these faculty development things and then eventually the university decided to create an office for service learning, but they chose the word community-based learning. And they did that because they thought the word service has negative connotations in the Egyptian community. Okay? Khidma, they didn't like the word service, so they said, let's use community-based learning. Okay? And it's also a broader term, so maybe you follow very strictly that methodology, but you may also kind of have other forms of working with the community in the form of research, in the form of whatever. Okay.
But outside of Egypt, in the literature, they're synonymous, CBL and service learning?
Some universities use service learning.
Okay.
Some universities have opted to use community-based learning. Okay. And there's always this debate about what should we call it. Okay. Right. So this is just for if you want to read a little bit more. I like this thing, this graphic. Okay. Two axes, the axis of learning, vertical, and the axis of service, okay? If you look at the lower left quadrant, if you have low service and low learning in your class, then go home. Sah? Yeah. If you have low learning but high service, this is what we spoke about at the beginning, then it's not really community-based learning. It's more like community service. It's not advancing the course learning outcomes. It's low learning. If you have high learning but low service, that upper left quadrant, high learning, low service, the students are exploiting the community. They're learning a great deal from the community. They're giving back very little. They're wasting the community time. Okay? If you have high learning and high service, this is what you're targeting. Okay? You want to create positive change. Positive. Okay? You want to work with the community. You want to work in an egalitarian setting. You want to learn. You want to advance your own learning outcomes. You want to do well in the course, but you want to make sure that whatever you've generated has made a difference in somebody's life. And the community wants to feel the same. They've gained something. It has not been time wasted. Okay? Mm-hmm. And they've supported students along the way. It's a new role. Okay?
I was just thinking in terms of what I wanted to do for digital rhetoric. So should I leave it till later?
Yeah, because we have a whole session on what it is you want to do in your class, which is the step-by-step activity. Yeah? These are just examples of some classes that have used community-based learning. There are a lot more, but these are just some from different disciplines, okay? So I'll go through some of these quickly. In labor economics, for example, okay, a faculty member was getting the students to work to analyze the labor market and the variables that are happening, all the different things that are changing in the labor market, and talking to the laborers and learning about their skills, learning about their needs, and then working to build capacity for the laborers so that they are prepared for changes in the labor market. So they've studied the economics of the market, what changes are happening, and then they worked with the laborers to learn about where they stand in terms of their skill set and where they need to be and they provided training sessions for them. So the laborers were prepared for changes in the economy. Okay? Writing for publication. This is a course I taught a number of times, but very quickly. I was teaching this course in 2006. And this was a time when about 3,000 Sudanese refugees assembled in Mustafa Mahmoud Square in Mohandesin in front of the UNHCR. And people were complaining about them in very negative terms, you know, like idol, okay, they don't smell very good, they've spoilt the area, you know, all kinds of horrible things. Nobody, well, I don't want to overgeneralize, but generally people did not perceive the individuals as people with, you know, stories and goals and dreams and families and what happened to them. So I was teaching writing for publication, and our theme, we had a theme, was citizenship and inclusion. Citizenship and inclusion. So I started asking the students about the Sudanese community and where they stand, and how is it that the Egyptian community can include rather than exclude them. And we decided that what we were going to publish was a collection of stories in the form of a book that is written in the first person, in the first voice. The students would work with a refugee, each couple of students, for example, would work with a refugee to collect their oral narrative, their story. What is it that they fled from? How did it impact them? What is their family about? What are their goals? What are they facing here? Their story, so that people would get to know them and see them as individual human beings with valuable lives, equally valuable lives. Okay? So that's what they did. We contacted an NGO, which is called AMIRA, okay, African and Middle Eastern Refugee Association. It's changed its name now, but that's what it was called. We contacted them. They put us in touch with refugees. We spoke with them. We built ties. We became friends. Facebook was just starting. And a lot of the younger Sudanese refugees had Facebook pages. They became friends with my students. They met, they collected their stories, and they wrote them out together in the first person. And then we submitted a book proposal, and we published the book. It was a very long community-based learning project. And yes, it was published. It was the first undergraduate written book published by AUC Press. But I didn't, by the end of the semester, we had a collection of stories, and the AUC Press said, these are not enough for a book. So we got another section, another course actually, in the rhetoric department, taught by Brooke Comer. She got her students to do the same. And by the end of that semester, we had enough for a publication. And it's in the library, it's a book. It's called Voices in Refuge. Yeah. And it's edited by a student who's now a faculty member in some university in the States. She's finished her PhD. Yeah. Anyway, teaching children's art from the art department. Okay. Faculty member. Can't remember her name. She developed a course where the students would go out into schools, after school programs, community schools, whatever, youth centers, and work with the children to teach them art. It fulfills the learning outcomes of the course. Urban landscapes, students go out, they look at dump areas, okay, and they create designs for making them green areas or making a community center or making something. And so much of that work at a very higher and more complex level is happening at the American University in Beirut. Maybe I'll get a chance a bit later to talk about that. But here, okay, people will work to change the landscapes. Who is the community partner? Al-Hay. Okay, they partner with Al-Hay. So it's not always an NGO. It could be a museum. It could be a school. It could be a university. It could be a university program on campus. Who you define as your community partner? We tend to talk about NGOs, but that's not the only community partner that you can work with. Okay? So they were working with the الحي, the municipality or baladeh or whatever. Okay, they were working with them to implement new designs. They would get sponsors, whatever, to make some change in the landscape, in the urban landscape, even if it's minimal. Especially if it's minimum, we're not going to do huge development projects. That's beyond a course. But small positive change is excellent change. Did you want to say something?
Is that Doris's course? Is that in Rent, the urban landscapes? Or?
I think Brooks
she was working with someone
problematics. Yeah, she was working with Rabia Shibli from AUB. Mm-hmm. Okay, but I don't think her students were designing. It wasn't an urban design course. Okay, they were looking at urban problematics. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But Rabia Shibli does work with design from AUB. Grant writing, I've spoken a little bit about something similar when I talked about my technical communication course, so I'm going to skip this. Okay? So, keep me in line, okay, please. So, types of community reach, okay? Yes, you can work with the organization, and this is what at AUC, it's one of the things that we choose to do. Sometimes students are working to serve the organization, the partner organization. So they're helping them develop a website, okay? They're helping them write grant proposals. They're helping them train the people in the NGO. So the service is to the NGO, okay? Another type of reach, service to community members through an NGO or through an organization, okay, or through a partner, I should say, because that partner does not need to be a non-governmental organization, as we said. Could be a library, a public library, okay, a hospital. We've worked with hospitals before. We've worked with Sabah Khamsin, Talata Sabah Khamsin. Yeah. Okay. Public libraries and children's literature class.
Hospitals as well.
Okay. So you're working through the organization to serve, okay, the community members. Okay, we do that as well. Service to a community, okay, immediately to the community, okay. This is not something that we encourage here, that you go straight to the community members without the intermediate agent.
It's like a fixer.
A journalist. Yani, henna, it's a bit risky. Mm. People will want to know what you're doing, what kinds of information you're collecting, who are you, okay, what are you using this information for. It puts you at risk.
Especially if you're in AUC.
Especially if you're in AUC. Okay. And then there's this other kind of service, working to change community through advocacy, action, you know, starting up these campaigns or something, creating awareness campaigns. All of these are this form of community change, which is also done at AUC and encouraged. So I'm going to test you now very quickly. Is this CBL? Okay. In an economics class, students study levels of poverty and evaluate global projects for poverty eradication. The students are encouraged to contribute to poverty alleviation by giving charity to poor children on Muhammad Mahmoud Street. Is this CBL? No. This is charity. Yeah. This is not CBL, okay? Okay. In a psychology class, students explore issues of health. They spend significant time in the community talking to poor children with cancer and providing counseling. Sorry, I think I used a different PowerPoint. In class, the students share experiences and draw conclusions about child illness, psychology, and behavior. Are they working with the community?
Yes, with the community. No, they're providing counseling, but they're not really working.
Yeah.
They're not,
by the way, this is not going to happen here because undergraduates do not provide counseling in the community, okay? But it's just an example.
There's no reciprocity.
There's no...
Meet the reciprocity kind of criteria.
I think so.
Criteria.
Yeah. It's a poor model.
Or like research.
Yeah. In a photography class, students shoot pictures of women in different underprivileged environments. They share their photographs and organize a class gallery. No. In a biology class, student groups put together nutritious meals and distribute them to street children. They get grades for how many meals they distributed. In a film class, students watch various documentaries on Bedouin life and evaluate how well each portrays the challenges faced by the indigenous group. Absolutely not. In a communication class, students research issues of female empowerment and literacy. In collaboration with an NGO, they create language lessons and teach rural women in a poor community. In class, they discuss their use of communication strategies and defend their persuasion techniques and appeals. Okay. In collaboration with the NGO, they've worked with the community members, they've taught them literacy classes, and then they go back and they analyze how well did they do in terms of the communication model that they are studying. Persuasive techniques, appeals, etc. This is community-based learning. Okay. And you can see from this picture, okay, how much the students have to learn. They're entering this community that is quite different from their own. Okay, look at the student, he's standing there, yani, bihawi, okay, all right, but all of the students in this public library were muhajabat, many of them munaqabat, they had to deal with this male student who comes from the American University in Cairo. There were a lot of stereotypes that were on both sides and they were broken down. Fil akhir, you know, the students learned, yeah, they look like these women who are munaqabat and there's a barrier and you can't see them. Underneath that, you know, they're young girls who are here to learn. They're still giggling with their friends. They're still, you know, enjoying the learning. And there's a communication gap that is bridged. It's a wonderful experience. The students learn and they gain the civic experience. Okay. I'm going to skip course design because let's do that when we do the activity. Okay, we'll just go through the course design points when we do the activity. Okay, principles of good practice. We want to be giving credit for the learning first and foremost, and not just for the service. So if my student is not doing the term paper, okay, he's contributing to discussions in class, he's spending a lot of hours in the community, okay, but there's no output in terms of what is required for the class assignments, then I cannot give the student an A because he's done an excellent job in the community. He's been respectful and committed and whatever, but there's no output in my class. How do I know you fulfilled the learning outcomes? You fulfilled the service outcomes. So credit is for learning. Now this is something that, of course there's this whole added field because of the community experience. But definitely, if I have two sections of the same course and one is using community-based learning and the other is not, I want to make sure that my section is as rigorous as the other one. Because some of the criticism that come from faculty who do not do CBL, okay, is that, you know, oh yeah, so they're getting all this credit for spending time in the community with fasahu, bilabu, sharfi, and it's not really about the learning, but that's not what it is. It's a lot of work, it's a lot of great work, there's a lot of added benefit, but the standard has to be maintained. Okay? So do not compromise academic rigor. Set learning goals for students. They know what they're learning. They know where they're heading through this service. They work with you to improve the learning experience. And you are saying, I learned from the students. Definitely, especially if you're in a community that you are experiencing for the same time, you are a co-learner. You don't know everything. Things change on the spot and you have to deal with the situation. You are not the know-all of the group, okay? You're co-learners. So provide educationally sound mechanisms to harvest that community learning. And that's the reflection exercise. Mm-hmm. How do you document all of that? How do you deal with student anxiety? How do you deal with people who still need a little bit of support, needs a bit of clarification? How do you do with people who have really found their path in life, you know? Minimize the distinction between the student's community learning role and the classroom learning role. Again, this is done through the reflection. They are connecting across what's happening in the community, what's happening in the classroom, how is it that they come together to fulfill the same goal? Okay, it's not that I'm doing two different things. It's one thing. I have my text and my community text, and they come together, okay, because it's an area that I'm learning about. Be prepared for uncertainty and variation in student learning outcomes. A lot of teachers want things to be neatly kind of planned out, and this is how you're going to implement them, and everything is clearly defined. That's not life. Okay? So be prepared for students not liking something, one student not doing as well as the others. A student you never noticed in class suddenly becoming, you know, the person that is leading the group because you've touched something in them. Okay? So be prepared for this kind of uncertainty and variation. Okay. Would you like a 5-minute kind of break to get something to drink, to whatever?
Hand eyes Maya, I'm going to go get water because everything here is
Yeah, I'd like Maya.